what we want. We want to love ourselves freely. Unfettered images of our grandmothers and our dreams. We want to praise our own God. And we want to see his reflection in our children's eyes. We want to draw him blue like jazz with long dreads and thick lips. We want music every day and especially on Sunday. We want dancing to be a prerequisite for success. We want the blues and jazz and funk, rock, soul, hip-hop, and R&B, and the wealth created from it to be our baby's inheritance. And we want it taught in all elementary schools all over the world. We want to speak for ourselves, we want to represent ourselves, and we don't want no handouts. Yeah, we don't want handouts. We just want everything we created and everything that was created as a result of what we created, and we want it with interest. We need a guaranteed income for all, education like fresh air and food and water and shelter, and be free from sickness and dis-ease. We need long life to collectively oppose death and stagnation. We need ideas and imagination. We should be against hoods like sheeted white ones, the ones that take and keep taking from the meek and often defenseless, even the glorified trap. Yeah, we against the trap too. We need our skies to be free from poison, to be able to breathe in sunshine and feel the wind on our faces. We need to end the war and oppression. We need the people to own their own labor. We need every corner of every country developed and every community empowered. We need it all turned right side up. We need the raw materials from the earth used in poverty anywhere exists. We need the calluses on our hands and the pains in our lower back to be added to our savings. Yeah, we need healthcare to be free and information to be free and ideas to be free and the news to be free and learning to be free and the people to be free. Yeah, the people. They gotta be free too. We are in a slavery in all forms and in exploitation, and we need all the money and all the banks in every part of the world to be used for our collective benefit. Yeah, we need all the money and all the banks in every part of the world to be used for our collective benefit. We need to outlaw lies and teach people's history in all languages from the viewpoint of all of us, not just a few of us. We need to outlaw everyone. We need to outlaw everyone. We need to outlaw everyone who opposes the right for all of us to vote. To be represented, no matter where we are, no matter what language we speak, no matter what God we pray to dismantle the Electoral College. Yeah, we need to dismantle the Electoral College and make racism and white supremacy illegal. We need to ban the Confederate flag and label every monument to genocide with a red letter like that book, or just plain tear them down. And replace them with statues of black and brown women that carried us through the darkest moments of history. We need to destroy all nuclear weapons, but first start with automatic rifles. We need to replace the war on drugs with a war on ignorance. We need to destroy the pipeline of cages and use the savings to develop the human spirit, to treat illness, social, mental, and physical. We need freedom. Not just the Bill of Rights, but rights to build our own lives, to be free from destituteness and hatred and hungry children, free from sickness with cures, underdevelopment and cold winter nights with no heat, free from losing our land, our block, our community, our homes, our family, free from choking to death in our own backyard. And schools that undermine our self-esteem, we need to be free from praising those that lynched us. We need to be free from praising those that lynched us, and free to pray in any language and to anyone we choose. Free to be free how we define it. We need to be free to be free how we define it, and free enough to know that the world is made up of all of us, not just some of us, and that only when all of us are free, none of us will be. And that our collective existence is tied directly to our individual existence, a coexistence with ourselves. Yeah, one big we, one big we, one big giant outrageous we. This is what we want and what we need. This is what we want and what we need, what we want and what we need, and we want it now. We want it now at this very moment, this second. This is what we want and what we need, the now, and the forever and the now and the forever and the now, the forever now. We want it, we want it, we want it, what we want and what we need, what we want and what we need and want and need and want and need, like a shower all over our body, like a shower all over our body. We want it. Like the sunshine kissing our faces. Yeah, like the sunshine kissing our faces.
Good evening and welcome everyone. My name is Natalie Augusta Filion. I'm Service Chief Sustainability Officer for the City of Newark. And I welcome you to this event tonight, the special virtual event entitled Advancing Environmental Justice in Newark. Today we'll be doing a film screening and a reported release. But before that, I'd like to just take a moment to express gratitude for those who came before us in so many interconnected struggles for justice. And I'd like to kick off tonight with a land acknowledgement. The land in which I live and work, the city of Newark, is part of the traditional homelands of the Lenape people. I pay respect to the Lenape people of the past, present, and future, and their continuing presence in their homeland and throughout the Lenape diaspora. For more than 500 years, Native communities have demonstrated resilience in the face of violent efforts to separate them from their land, culture, and each other. They remain at the forefront of the movement to protect Mother Earth and the life she sustains. The music video played to open tonight's event is What We Want by our Honorable Mayor, Raz Baraka. This piece moves me deeply. It reminds me of the many reasons why we continue to push back against racism and bigotry in all of its forms. Despite decades of activism and local leadership, we live with the irrefutable fact that the color of your skin remains the most statistically significant predictor of whether you live near a landfill or a toxic waste site. Our Black brothers and sisters are 3 times more likely to die from exposure to air pollutants when compared to their white counterparts. Factoids like these underpin our fight against environmental racism and are at the core of the work we will be highlighting this evening. I'm so grateful to welcome all of you here today. This evening's program will include some opening remarks from our esteemed officials, Mayor Raz J. Baraka and Deputy Commissioner Olivia Glenn, followed by a screening of a film entitled The Sacrifice Zone. We'll be closing the event with a panel discussion between 3 local leaders who have unique perspectives and roles to play with respect to the implementation of our shared environmental justice goals and our vision here in the city of Newark. These include City Planning Officer Chris Watson, our Newark Environmental Commission co-chair, Cynthia Millon, and the Deputy Director for Organizing and Advocacy at the Ironbound Community Corporation, Maria Lopez Nunez, who's also featured in the film tonight. This event is being recorded and live streamed to Facebook, where my colleagues, Irina Gorski-Steiner and John Gordon, are tracking the conversation thread. We welcomed you to begin thinking ahead about some of the questions you'd like to pose to our panelists. We'll also are joined in the Facebook event by the film producer, Julie, who also welcomes any questions and will be tracking the conversation thread. So without further ado, I'd like to bring on our Deputy Commissioner, Olivia Glenn, who will be kicking off our remarks this evening. Olivia C. Glenn serves as Deputy Commissioner to Acting Commissioner Sean M. LaTourette, appointed in July. Olivia was responsible for prioritizing the advancement of the New Jersey Department of Environmental Protection's goals and the administration's environmental justice and equity goals. A longtime advocate for ensuring underserved communities have access to the outdoors, Olivia believes every New Jerseyan has a right to experience and enjoy the benefits of nature.
Good evening to everyone, and thank you so much for inviting me to be here today. So first, I just want to give recognition to your wonderful mayor, Mayor Baraka, and that beautiful moving film presentation, as well as to Chief Sustainability Officer Natalie Augusto Filion, who are both doing incredible work in the city of Newark. I truly thank you for inviting me here this evening to speak with you as Newark's Environmental Resources Inventory makes its debut. It is truly one impressive tool and the culmination of a great deal of hard work and collaboration between government and engaged citizens. Like many of you who are watching online live, I've spent a great deal of my professional and personal life working to ensure that every New Jerseyan has the right to experience and enjoy the benefits of nature and a healthy environment. As the Deputy Commissioner for Environmental Justice and Equity in the New Jersey Department of Environmental Protection, I am honored to be leading the state's efforts to aid overburdened communities. And I am deeply encouraged that the DEP's work on a state level and your work on the local level reflect the same dedication to assuring that the welfare of residents who have been subject to a disproportionately high number of environmental and public health stressors, particularly the cumulative impacts of pollution, is front and center in our considerations. I'd just like to take a moment to share some details about the state's landmark environmental justice law that was signed in Newark in September. The environmental justice law seeks to remedy the historic injustice experienced by Black groups in our state that are 35% low income, 40% minority, or 40% limited English proficient. The new law requires the DEP to evaluate the environmental and public health impacts of certain facilities on overburdened communities when reviewing certain permit applications for major sources of air pollution, such as gas-fired power plants and cogeneration facilities. Also, resource recovery facilities or incinerators, certain sewage treatment plants, transfer stations, or solid waste facilities and other facilities. The law also ensures that our state's overburdened communities have a strong voice about what happens in their neighborhoods and will make businesses more accountable for the construction they desire and the actions they take. We have completed our last topical stakeholder meeting on the environmental justice law just last week and will reconvene stakeholders in late June to review all of the feedback that we have received. If you've missed any of those previous meetings or you would like to weigh in and help shape the direction that we're going in, you can visit our DEP website for the Office of Environmental Justice at nj.gov/DEP/EJ. There you can find previous meeting recordings as well as give us your feedback on the materials that are posted. Our hope is to issue draft rules this fall, and we hope to have the new rule adopted in early 2022. We believe that the environmental justice law will have meaningful and lasting influence on Newark and New Jersey's other 330 municipalities that have overburdened Black groups within their borders. Just as important, however, is the work that you, members of the community, and elected officials have been doing right here at home. To see all of you engaged in this effort together, committed to making your city stronger, fairer, and greener for all of its residents is truly extraordinary. Thank you, Mayor Baraka, for leading this incredible team who put the most vulnerable members of your city first, for building on the promise that a city can protect its environment and public health and still grow a good, solid economy. And I want to acknowledge the many contributions of tonight's panelists, and I salute each of you, Maria Lopez Nunez, Cynthia Mayon, and Chris Watson. Building the environmental resources inventory and passing the environmental justice and cumulative impacts ordinance can only help to better public health and environmental outcomes. These two tools are excellent examples of how local resources and laws, coupled with state rules like the EJ law, can complement each other. Such local ordinances and state land use rules dovetail efficiently. These undertakings further the promise that together, residents, businesses, and government at all levels can address issues that once seemed intractable and extend environmental justice, that we can choose a path to protect the environment and public health for everyone in New Jersey. Thank you so much.
Thank you again, Deputy Commissioner. So grateful to you. We have on the screen again the website, and we can drop it into the Facebook thread, the conversation thread. We will be making these slides available as well, so that if anyone wants to come back and reference them, they're able to. If it wasn't clear, New Jersey is leading the nation with respect to the rulemaking process for environmental justice that folks at the DEP that Livia's team is pulling together. So again, very grateful to have you here with us tonight. All right, well, I want to transition us to the film screening. But before doing that, I just want to give a little bit of additional context setting about Newark's Environmental Justice and Cumulative Impacts Ordinance and the report that we are releasing tonight. So the first thing that I'll flag is that this report is a compilation of about 70 maps that showcase in one place all of the environmental features located within the city of Newark. So both the negative aspects that you would expect we would be referencing when we're talking about conversations of environmental justice, as well as environmental benefits, like where all of our urban farms and gardens are located, for example. So Newark is one of only a handful of local governments that have specific rules, policies, and laws, or other forms of regulation regarding environmental justice and this concept of cumulative impacts. This report, that's the screen on the screen here, there's a capture from the report, is authored by Newark's own Dr. Ana Baptista. And it reviews policies from a couple dozen local governments, and their efforts range from policies that ban specific types of polluting facilities if they're located within overburdened areas of the community. They might mandate expanded environmental review processes, or they develop a targeted land use or measure or a public health code intervention in order to reduce pollution exposure and risk. So in Newark specifically, the Environmental Justice and Cumulative Impacts Ordinance is nested within the framework of how the city makes decisions about land use. So many individuals will have seen something like this in their neighborhood at some point. If you're from Newark and you know that there's a vacant building or an empty parcel, at some point a sign will go up on the physical location within a few feet of that location, indicating that there is a hearing, a public hearing. This is probably the most common way that people are aware of having an opportunity to sort of offer their input about a development decision. All of these decisions are guided by a framework that's laid out in Newark's master plan. And later during our panel, I'm sure that our esteemed colleague Chris will talk a little bit about the master planning process and the fact that we're undergoing an update to that. In Newark specifically, the policy that sets out our environmental justice vision is within this broader framework. We can go back just one slide. It's within this broader framework of how development decisions are made. So there's an entire process that unfolds as there's a decision about how to develop a property, and our environmental justice law sort of impacts this process. So the next slide, again, as I noted, the slides will be made available, shows the specific parameters which would cause this additional environmental review to happen. So our Environmental Justice and Cumulative Impacts Ordinance is triggered when a applicable facility, so any commercial, light manufacturing, or industrial use, needs to get some kind of permit, either from the NJDEP, from the Essex County Utilities Authority, et cetera. So if that environmental permitting process is underway, there will be a requirement that the site plan applicant, submit what's called a checklist. And that checklist references the environmental resources inventory that we've compiled here, and also results in an advisory opinion from our environmental commission. which is co-chaired by another one of our panelists this evening. So you can see Newark's environmental resources inventory, all 200 plus pages plus appendices, at any point by referencing this link. It's bit.ly/NWK, shorthand for Newark, ERI, shorthand for Environmental Resources Inventory 2021. And what you'll find there is not only the ability to download the PDF, but also an ability to sort of interact with the data layers. And I'll talk about that briefly tonight. So who do we expect will use the ERI? Why is this useful? Why are we talking about it? We would really love for it to be used as a reference, as a source of data, of evidence, to inform our local decision makers, not only our the administration and the Office of Planning and Zoning and the various boards and commissions of the city, but as well for community advocates, for our environmental justice leaders, for the general public, for researchers, and we're making all of that data publicly available. And so in the next slide, you'll see that we're going to go through a very high level review of the environmental resources inventory. So as I mentioned, our Environmental Justice and Cumulative Impacts Ordinance is a nationally recognized legislation. It requires applicants for commercial or industrial developments to submit an environmental checklist with their application that details how they are proposing to avoid or mitigate any environmental harms in overburdened areas of the community. And they're required to submit that with their application submission. They're required to reference the environmental resources inventory. So this environmental resources inventory you'll see is divided. It's categorized into four high-level parts, and we'll go through each of them in turn, but it provides a bit of a sort of a framework for where to find what you might be looking for. So part one, pollution sources and contaminated sites. There's several maps here, but we've just picked out two to sort of showcase today, and we selected a couple that are sort of referenced in the film that we're about to see. So first you'll see the collection area, the area from which municipal solid waste and other forms of waste are delivered or brought to Newark to be processed at the Essex County Waste to Energy facility run by Covanta Essex. In the next slide, what you'll see is that Covanta Essex is one of several waste and recycling type facilities that are located within Newark borders. And so in the many of our conversations about environmental justice often talk about solid waste siting of solid waste facilities, where they're located across the country, and how they are often disproportionately higher numbers of them are located in communities of color. And so we very much see that here in Newark. When you go on to looking for the kinds of data that describe the built environment of a Newark, we see we provide data that describe our sort of environmental assets, where our tree canopy is located, where the prevalence of areas that lack trees. And so here we have an example of the tree canopy cover layer that's available on the ERI website and in the report, as well as an example of how the lack of trees, locations where our urban agriculture is located throughout the municipality. Now, when we talk about environmental justice, usually when we describe overburdened communities or underserved communities, et cetera, there are two primary indicators that are used consistently, not only by the community of advocates, but also the academic community. We recognize that race and income are the two sort of factors that determine lack of services or various kinds of ways of describing being in quote unquote overburdened community. And so one of the map layers that's available in the ERI is this display of race and ethnicity that's color-coded by dots. This is a way that the census tracks information. And so every dot here represents 15 people. They're sort of randomly placed. It's not like exactly your family in your building, but rather randomly placed to represent the census tract. And so that's one of the data layers available in the ERI. And then here's a more common representation of how the information is shared. It's shared at the census tract level. So this is a statistical unit that's used for analysis and helps our local decision making, because various of these tracts are kind of analyzed at each of the neighborhood scales. And so this one demonstrates the percent of people living below the poverty line in each of the census, the 200 plus census tracts in the city of Newark. I actually think I quoted that incorrectly. Maybe someone can correct me later. And then our last section is sort of what I would think of as your basic information about the landscape of the city. Where are wetlands located? What kinds of soils do we have? What's the elevation of the city? And so we've picked out a couple slides here to just give you a high level overview of what is available in this amazing resource that many of the folks on this call have helped to develop. And so I want to move on to just sort of acknowledging the team of folks that helped us to draft the environmental resources inventory. And before doing so, just flagging that there, in addition to the PDF report, there is an interactive website that is under development. So kudos to the folks that are helping to build this site. If you access this page, you see that there are multiple sort of tabs at the bottom. The overview of the environmental resources inventory, an opportunity to explore the data, targeted information about how developers should fill out the forms, and more for anyone who wants to replicate our methodology. So with respect to exploring the data, you'll see that as you're scrolling through this site, you can click on the sort of side boxes and zoom in, or even just sort of interact with the map, and it'll pop up information about the given layer that you selected. So in this case, you'll see that the selected box is PM, or particulate matter 2.5, which is a concentration of a particular size of a particle of air pollutants. And so again, you can kind of interact with the data, click, see where you live, and see what comes up. This is the Explore the Data tab. Again, all of this is under development, and we really welcome feedback and comments about the utility of it and improvements that you might like to see. In the tab called Fill Out the Forms, EJCIO Forms, this is specifically intended with an audience of the site plan applicants, developers that are looking to build in the city of Newark, do a project. Here, there's an opportunity to do a site-based address search. So you can access this tool, enter the address of the proposed site, the proposed development, and the web tool will automatically generate information about the number of sites that are, the number of regulated sites located within a given boundary, a certain buffer of that particular location. The idea being that anyone in this particular area is not only experiencing the pollution impacts from the proposed development, the what would be coming, but also already living with a certain amount of pre-existing exposures. So that's what's on the website. I've gotten a message indicating that some folks are having trouble with the audio, and I'm not 100% sure what to do with that. So I guess I'm going to keep going and hope that if anyone is having trouble, they can access the recording after the fact, because we will be having the event recording available for folks to watch later on. I, even though I like to joke we're in the 17th month of 2020 right now, I still find myself needing to turn up my volume or to check if I am using the wrong speakers or something. So just putting it out there for folks. Okay, so my thank yous and my just acknowledgments of the team that worked so hard on pulling this report together over the last 10 months. First of all, we brought on two stellar graduate interns, one of whom is with us today, helping to run the back end logistics of this event, Rachel Bowers and Irina Gorski-Steiner. Nate Irwin in the Office of Planning and Zoning has been just an incredible partner to work with in terms of making sure that all of this information is available online, and that we are integrating the information that we've captured into Newark's master planning process, etc. I was also one of the authors, so thank you. And then we had a great advisory committee who set the vision for making this possible. I want to recognize Newark's Environmental Commission, without whom none of this work would be possible. Cynthia Millon, Michael Molina, both of the Environmental Commission and both part of the team that helped to set the vision. They also have been for many years working on the implementation of this program and recruiting all sorts of help and support to do so. And I will hopefully allow Cynthia, we'll have some space to talk a little bit about what that experience has been like and the challenges that we've had getting us to this point. We also had Matthew Da Silva and Tim Jensen from the planning office offer sort of advisory comments. And I want to really throw a huge shout out and recognize the value of having such wonderful EJ leaders right within our community here. Dr. Anna Batista, who is a Newark native, as well as Dr. Nikki Sheets, who both are on the New Jersey Environmental Justice Alliance. The Alliance is one of the organizations that helped to push the creation of these policies. And Dr. Nikki Sheets in particular is currently a sitting member of the White House Environmental Justice Advisory Commission. So seeing that the learnings and the lessons learned that we've had here in Newark and in New Jersey can continue to sort of have ripple effects across the country through the participation of Newark-based and New Jersey based leaders in broader conversations about this work. There's been an incredible collection of folks that have worked on this over the years, and I really want to call out both Joni Mitchell and Jacqueline, who were early researchers that supported the compilation and development of the data that undergirds the Environmental Resources Inventory. Okay, we're going to transition into our film screening next, and I just want to flag that this film is about 30 minutes long, and as soon as we're going to use the film as the foundation for grounding this conversation, when we move into our panel discussion. So with no further ado, I will ask our wonderful tech wizard Theo Liggins to start the film, and just flag that we do have the filmmaker with us in the Facebook chat. So if anybody has specific questions that, you know, trigger you and you want to sort of know, you can hear from Julie in the Facebook threads. Thank you, and see you in a bit. Enjoy the film. Thank you all for watching that with us, and a special thank you to Talking Eyes Media and Julie Winokur, who is on the Facebook thread, conversation thread with us. I'm gonna go ahead and encourage any questions that folks may have. We did receive the one that came in from Trish, and we'll be addressing that. I'm gonna start with a couple of our prepared questions before transitioning into the questions from the Facebook, but just wanted to encourage you all to go ahead and chat any questions you have. If they're specifically directed at one individual, please feel free to include that person's name, and otherwise we will proceed with the panel here. So I'm going to start by just doing a very quick introduction to our panelists and then allow them to sort of share a little bit about themselves. First, we have Cynthia Mayon, who is a writer, editor, translator, and urban beekeeper who lives in Newark. She was formerly environmental justice organizer at the Ironbound Community Corporation and serves as co-chair of the Newark Environmental Commission. Cynthia, go ahead and turn on your camera so we can all see you. Chris Watson is a decade-old Newark resident of the city's West Ward. He's the city's planning officer and works with units of city zoning, planning, and boards and commissions on various planning projects that achieve the administration's Newark Forward pillars. And Chris is a keeper of chickens. Maria Lopez Nunez, as you learn from the film, is an Ironbound resident, and she serves as a deputy director of organizing and advocacy at Ironbound Community Corporation. And she was also recently appointed to the White House Environmental Justice Advisory Council. Maria and Chris, please feel free to turn your cameras on. So I'm going to pose our first question to the panelists. And as you go through and answer them sort of each in turn, I'd love you to just start by telling us a little bit about yourself, if there's anything else that you'd like to sort of build on my mini sort of bios. So I am very curious for folks, everyone on this panel is familiar with the Environmental Resources Inventory Report and obviously our local legislation. Tell me a little bit from your individual perspective, what are some of the major priorities and some of the major barriers that you see for advancing environmental justice in our community? I'll start with Cynthia.
Great. Well, you know, I admire this film because it really covered a lot of what we live with here, but it's not everything, but you get to see a lot of it. I think greatest barriers are kind of reputation, custom tradition, something to do with zoning that creates a situation where quite polluting activities continue to apply for permits in Newark, and we have direct experience with that. Some of it is quite unnerving and even insulting to our community. A lot of waste-related businesses, you know, like at least 35 or 40 in a very concentrated area. The incinerator, of course, the Port of Newark with the trucks, which are diesel trucks, and they are usually old owner-operated trucks, misclassified, basically. So that's the biggest source of air pollution. So I think what's really important is this concept of cumulative impact, which I now work a lot at the federal level. So I get to kind of more of an overview of what's going on with bills and stuff like that. But this concept of cumulative impact is something that polluters and their friends really don't like to have addressed. And I've even seen bills rejected or that term utilized. People don't like to admit that layers and layers of pollution are what are a tremendous health problem. And yet that is what we have here. So the more we see that recognized and be able to work with that, the better off we'll be for addressing these problems in the future. So I'll stop there and hope I get another chance to say some more.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that, Cynthia and Chris.
Thanks, Natalie. And I want to start off by saying thanks for having me in this most important discussion. I think it's timely and needed. And congratulations on the heavy lift of advancing the ERI. I think when we think about barriers, I like to culture it around or frame it around education. I think the sacrifice zone has just shown us, you know, how historical the, you know, Newark's, although we're living in a post-industrial country, we still are inheritance of our industrial past. And I think that education about the current pollution conditions and what has caused it historically is one of our barriers. And I think also, you know, how do we talk not just barriers, but how we talk solutions? You know, I think that ties into the barriers also, and how we talk solutions that are both macro and solutions that are micro. And I think Cynthia touched on this. at the macro level, how we treating planning as a tool, because we know coming out of a planning process is a concrete zoning that in a sense disallows for these industries to come into our neighborhood. So I think from the macro level is how do we as planners, always as an administration is thinking about these issues and how we in a sense informing our residents at the macro level as to some of the solutions that they themselves could advance. So, you know, Maria showed in the film where, you know, you can, in a sense, prevent garbage from getting to Covantes if you compost at home. You know, I know nuancedly, like I live in a household with 9-year-old twins who are like the most fastidious composters, you know? So it's like, how do we, at the very micro level, do that type of education? And at the macro level, understand, you know, we have a charge and a charge that is actually legislative to us by the municipal land use law, and that is to protect the health and safety of our residents, and planning as a tool can actually advance that.
Thank you, Chris. Maria.
Yeah, I'm always thankful to be on a panel with folks in Newark, because it's interesting to see how much our work is recognized nationally, but how often folks in our city don't know that, like, you know, cumulative impacts, Newark was the first city to pass a cumulative impacts ordinance, and how that made its way to be a statewide law that is the strongest environmental justice law in the country. And even as I say that, it makes me really sad, because when you ask an elementary school kid at Hawkins Street School, you know, how do you think planning decisions are made? They're like, well, people, you know, they look around, they say what's good, what's bad, you know, which I explained planning to a 7-year-old. And a 7-year-old understands that if you look around and there's all these smokestacks, maybe don't add another one. You know, if there's all this waste related industry, maybe don't add another one, because the people can't go anywhere. And we're not advocating for relocation plans. You know, we're just advocating that industry stop coming to Newark and stop kind of, we have the opposite of a red line, right? We've been just boxed in with industry, and now we're fighting the sludge facility and the natural gas plant from coming in, right? So that's after everything we saw in the movie, we have these two big threats to us. One that we're trying to fight on the local level, and then the natural gas plant that unfortunately, because it's a public utility, has to get fought on other levels as well. So I'll just, you know, start with that of how, as much progress as we've made, how it still doesn't make common, it doesn't pass a common sense test. A law like this shouldn't be historic. It should just be the way that we do planning and zoning.
Awesome. And I have one more question for the panelists, and I will recognize there are some questions coming into the Facebook chat. So if you could just keep your responses short so we can get some of the audience questions. The second question is, can you talk a little bit about how the information compiled in the environmental resources inventory, this data, this evidence that we've compiled, how does it help you, your organizations, advance the work of environmental justice that you are committed to doing? And just to flag that we are seeing the questions coming in, and we're sharing them with the panelists as they come in. So we'll stay just a few minutes after 7:30 to be able to tackle at least two or three of those. Thank you. So I'll let you all take it in any order that you like in terms of this last question about the use of evidence and data to help advance your work.
Go ahead, Cynthia.
No, go ahead, Chris.
I would say, Natalie, you know, before the ERI, it was hard for us to protect what we didn't qualify and quantify, right? And we know we needed to advance environmental justice, and certainly the cumulative impact ordinance, as groundbreaking as it was a tool to do just such. And I think what we have now in this ERI is a concrete way of saying that, you know, we need to be cognizant of the areas where we see that environmental resources are lacking. It gives us an opportunity to make decisions around health outcomes, around where we advocate for certain truck routes to go through. It certainly gives us a more nuanced understanding as to the environmental resources we have in our cities, its vulnerabilities, and how we should advance planned and zoning efforts to protect such and even scaffold such where they're very resource light. I wanted to touch as on something that I needed to say. My first response is that I think like one of the priorities coming out of this ERI is that how now we should even look at the NGA Environmental Justice Ordinance and ensure that we use the high standards of that ordinance and revisit our cumulative impact ordinance to ensure that our now local cumulative impact ordinance have the level of statutory level that the NGA ordinance has, and in a sense, really staff up our environmental commission, who plays a pivotal role in safeguarding against environmental degradation through applications that they get an opportunity to review and provide comments to either our central planning board or our zoning board. So I think it's how do we really support the environmental commission and staff it up in such a way that they can have the empowerment to advance what the EJ law and our cumulative impact ordinance would like to advance in terms of protection.
I just want to add really briefly to what Christopher said. People should know that the Environmental Commission is made up of all volunteers, Newark residents, so all the time we spend is time that we give. The Environmental Justice Cumulative Impacts Ordinance is used by the commission, as Chris referred to evaluate certain permit requests and that if they are industrial and commercial. And it has been a really hard thing to work with. This tool should make it a whole lot easier. And I want to cite Nat Irwin and some of the other people at City who are streamlining this. So it will be harder for applicants to lie, and it will also put on applicants, they will have to see and show the surroundings of what they intend to build. And it should be faster and easier to use for everybody. So there's a lot there, but it has always been my dream that this also be a tool available to the public. And so I'm really happy there's going to be an outwardly facing user-friendly site, because I would love people to use that in schools and, you know, because you really can learn the city that way. And so I'm really glad it's going to serve that dual purpose.
Thank you. Any thoughts from you, Maria, about how data advances your work and how the ERI in particular can be helpful?
You know, that's always a complicated question for me. It shouldn't be. But data just lets other people finally believe us, right? Like I said, a seven-year-old can tell you how polluted our neighborhood is because they can smell it, they can taste it, and they can see it. And so it makes me really sad that it takes so long to get data. And I'm so grateful to you, Natalie, and to the commission for having pushed this work along so that now, you know, city planners and Chris's department can see it and say, okay, there's the data, you know, and now we can try to hold people accountable. But, you know, I did see in the chat, I'll try to wrap that answer in, about COVID, right? And we saw the disproportionate death from COVID and how COVID was linked to air pollution. And so I'm hoping that now that we have data, we can also have urgency, both from our city and from our residents, right? We need to make it politically unviable for it to be even a consideration. Because the truth is that as much as we have data and new laws, it's still, we don't have the jurisdiction. You know, once you learn how bad and corrupted the system is, it doesn't protect us. And so that's why as residents, we have a responsibility to create enough noise and to make it just political suicide for people to even support projects that hurt us, that kill us, that make the air to breathe that much more difficult, because it definitely disproportionately impacts Black and brown people. That's why industry keeps targeting Newark time and time again.
I want to lift up one question that builds on what you were just saying, Maria, and comes from Audris Torres, who's saying that with the state consistently pushing harmful development into our communities, why aren't these projects being stopped at the top, and why are they relying on residents to constantly push back? So I'm curious, you know, I'll just loop a couple other questions here, which is has to do with sort of what protections are already in place to ensure that, you know, we're not adding to the cumulative impact of burden. A question from Christian Rodriguez, as well as sort of another one that, I think that one was posted twice in the chat here, but let's take those two together, because I think the gist of it is, how do we ensure that the onus doesn't have to be on residents to push back? Curious for thoughts from any of the panelists.
I think, Maria, you want to go? Go ahead, Maria.
You can go. I just want, go ahead.
I think, Natalie, and that goes to like the macro level of education and solution, right? What the city allows is for land use applications to come through based on what is permitted on land. And I think it dovetails nicely into Maria's comments and observation about when you ask a child in a neighborhood that is overburdened with pollution, you know, what is the planning process that leads here? There's a level of ignorance, although they know that, you know, they're suffering from that pollution. And I think what we need to course correct at the macro level is how, and not just using planning as a tool, but how, when we get to master planning, how we, in our community engagement strategies, how we use those strategies, one, to educate, and one, to listen to our residents as to how are their neighborhoods functioning for them? How are their neighborhoods promoting a healthy life course, right? And I think what we need to do is that when we hear those voices and translate those voices, is that we ensure that our land use laws are strong enough that they disallow for these levels of contamination. So I think it's a macro thing we can solve, and we can solve by ensuring that we engage our residents and really and truly write laws that reflect their concerns. And again, I know I harken back to our charge as public servants, is that our role and goal is to protect the health and safety of our residents. And I think planning, again, as a tool to keep, as a tool can accomplish that.
Yeah, I mean, I appreciate the question. I would love a just society where, you know, you assumed like that the Department of Environmental Protection was protecting you, that planning was going all well, right? But planning is relatively new in the course of history. So there's like many reasons why we ended up where we are. And one of them is racism. And when we acknowledge that our society is fundamentally built on a lot of racist principles, right? It was built on genocide, displacement of people, and with using enslaved labor, then we come to this, and it's hard to say and expect that from the top we're going to be protected. And that's why at Ironbound Community Corporation, we try to organize our neighbors and organize ourselves as just community residents. Because like Chris is saying, we're about to go into a master planning process. That means that everyone in the city should come out in droves, because then we can hold Chris accountable. And I'm sure, you know, I what I love about this administration is that the Barack administration keeps saying they want to be held accountable. And now it's up to us also as residents to show up to the meetings, demand what we want. And when the documents come out, follow up, right? If things don't look right, or in instances like the sludge plant, I'm gonna keep coming back to it, of course, where they call it biosolids, right? They're making up something, even though sludge processing is forbidden, then we hold them accountable. We appeal it and we go through a process to make sure that our laws are enforced. It's always up to us as residents and for us to stick up for each other as neighbors and as residents of Newark. You know, Newark has to defend Newark because we know that the state is not going to.
And Cynthia, I invite you to, you know, build on this question and also target one of the first questions that came through in the chat from Trish Cortado, which says, I'd like to know how the city's law will stop the sludge plant from coming into town, and how can it help fight facilities like the sludge facility that are trying to sneak in like they're doing right now, despite the EJ bill passing. So anything, and I'll let the audience know that we did intend this to be a 90-minute meeting, and this will be our last question.
So yeah, that's a really interesting question, because the sludge plant issue, we've known for a while that the EJ cumulative impacts ordinance is not strong enough, that it is imperfect, right? We've been working with it for a while, trying to make it work. And I think it does need to be upgraded. And I'm hoping that with stronger statewide law, that will be the key to that. The other thing is that you've got different, I don't know what you call them, departments in the city. There's like planning and then there's zoning. And at the moment, we're trying to get the sludge plant moved to the zoning board, because there are a number of prohibited uses in that plan by zoning that aren't prohibited at the planning board level. So that is our current strategy. On June 10th, the Zoning Board of Newark will hear whether to take that case. And I urge everybody who cares about this stuff to be on the Zoom that night so that they know, because we have been very vigilant about that. I mean, that there's different stages to that, but this is the stage we're at with the plant. we're trying to use the tools we have, but they are imperfect tools.
And I think what I'll ask is just for a quick round of sort of closing thoughts from our panelists so that we can transition to wrapping up the meeting. And from my perspective, if any of you can sort of share, this work can be very draining. I think a lot of us were often sitting with the anxiety and the reality of the legacy of contamination that we've inherited and the challenges of policymaking and advocacy. And if you could just share in, you know, less than a sentence, what gives you hope? What keeps you fighting in this fight? And that way we can end on a positive note.
I'll go first. the people. You know, the people of Newark, the beauty of Newark, the beauty of our city, the beauty of our state. It is an honor to serve our city in this way. I'll never forget the opportunity.
Chris, would you like to go next?
I think, first of all, Max, thanks for this meaningful dialogue. For me personally, I've been living in Newark for 14 years and my kids are being raised here. And it's important that as we root ourselves in neighborhoods, we champion those neighborhoods because we're championing ourselves. And what I appreciate, not only in this call, but as I walk around the city hall, I see everyday champions that go home to a zip code that is within Newark. So, you know, there are no friends and foe here. There are people that are trying to advance an agenda for Newark that benefits all. So I think I just want to make a plug that, you know, that this is a so important moment in leadership shepherded by Mayor Baraka as we move Newark forward stronger. All Newarkers, especially for those that are most vulnerable residents. And I want to make a plug that, you know, in this documentary, we saw how rich the Darren Baum neighborhood is. And, you know, my office is advancing the Forward Bomb, the REMUS master plan. And it's recognizing that these two, in this industrial peninsula and this rich residential neighborhood, they're both not going anywhere. But how do we find opportunities to have transition between these two zones? And how do we finally forward a plan that really protects our residents and still give our industries opportunities to grow? So, you know, and that charge has really been championed by Mayor Baraka, and who's, you know, given us instructions actually as to how we change the architectural language of our city to kind of dismantle those structural impediments that have resulted in some of the barriers that our residents face. And Maria, thanks for making that plug for the master plan. And you're right, we are embarking on a new plan for our city, and we should be rolling that out in the next coming months. And we're going to ensure that there's a plan rooted in a community development strategy that reach every Newarker. And we really encourage people to be part of that process, because being part of that process will help us, in a sense, advocate for a new master plan for our city with a zoning ordinance that is cemented around the principles of health equity and resilience.
And I'll let Maria close us.
Thank you. You know, and yes, thank you for having us. You know, one thing that for sure keeps me going is as much as people might not know about the city of Newark, you know, we have such a bad reputation. So many amazing things have happened in the city of Newark, and not just in terms of environmental justice. We also passed the right to counsel. You know, there's inclusionary zoning. Newark is just I love thinking about the rich legacy of the work after the Newark Rebellion in this city, right? Like, it is a city of organizers and of people who just refuse to have the wool pulled over their eyes, right? It's always people always searching for truth and fighting for more, demanding for more, more, more from our administration, no matter who's in charge. And I love the spirit of this city. And like Nancy Zach says, as long as we don't all give up at the same time, I'm sure there's always someone to tap in and fight for the city. You know, there's when one goes down, another one comes up, because we're a city of fighters and warriors, always striving to just do it for Newark. You know, it's not a race against anyone else. That's what I love about Newark. doesn't really compare itself. It's just trying to be the best Newark it can be. And that is definitely inspiring. And I love my colleagues who I could tell by the chats are on this, they're always paying attention and we're always ready to hold whoever accountable, right? Even ourselves, because at the end of the day, it's about the community members that bump into us at the supermarket or the laundromat. Newark's a small city in that way. And I've run into Chris at Whole Foods, you know, you can run into anybody. Anywhere in the city and tell them what you think. And that's something I absolutely adore about our city. So thank you all for being with us tonight. And I hope that whoever's involved, go check out Ironbound Justice and get more engaged with the work that we have to do moving forward. Thank you all.
Thank you so much.
I know you asked for a sentence, so I finally thought of my sentence. I come to work here because I go home here.
You just want to go after me, Natalie. See this? Go, Chris.
Well, I will flag that we do have some links for you. I confess that I forgot to put the Office of Sustainability's link here. So it's newarknj.gov/sustainability. We'll probably edit this slide just a tiny bit before putting the whole slide deck online for anyone to access. The film is obviously proprietary artistic content, and so it will not be on the recording past the next 24 hours. It will be available for anybody who would like to watch the film free of charge for the next 24 hours. And then after that, it will be clipped out in the permanent recording that's saved on Facebook of the event. Just FYI. And I also wanted to, you know, just make a plug for all of these organizations and for, again, the filmmakers who have made it possible for us to do this screening and to really ground this conversation in the real context of a fight for environmental justice in our city. So thank you again, everyone, for being here. I want to give a quick shout out to our tech support team, Theo Liggins, John Gordon, and Irina Gorski-Steiner, who are helping make this event possible. Thank you again, and have a lovely rest of your evening. Thank you.